Hi everyone, and welcome to my biohack panel. I am very fortunate to have two friends with me today, Ken Kato and Eric Dorfey. And today we want to talk a little bit about red versus blue versus green, the logical disconnect between the different teams and large organizations. Gentlemen, please go ahead and say hi to the crowd.
I'll go first. Hey, I'm Eric. I work at a medical device manufacturing company, and I currently positioned in an enterprise role helping oversee and mentor teams build their applications and get them out in the public app stores.
My name is Ken Kato. I'm a technologist. I split my time between Boston and Washington, D.C. I like to do a lot of different things around security. I came from the finance and healthcare background. So I spent a lot of time thinking about not just how to keep data secure for individual companies, but for individuals themselves.
With that, we're going to talk a little bit about the red versus blue versus green. Now, from your experience, how do you think in a large organization these three teams tend to work together? Do they do this well? Do they struggle? And what are some of the commonalities you see in the struggles?
Well, Erica, I would like to take a swing at this if you don't mind.
Sure. So it really depends on the team. My background, I came from a business unit that specialized in devices that one of the panelists here is very familiar with. And working with teams to build, maintain, release these applications across several different releases, doing things like penetration testing, taking that feedback in and making mitigations or making corrections and such. When you get to large teams, my experiences have been mixed depending on the project, where it is in its life cycle. Is it a new product or is it something that is going through maintenance releases and different kind of situations where maybe there is a dedicated security engineer on the team injected in the project from day one, or maybe you have another project where due to rollover or things like that, people leave the company and we have to onboard the security engineers into our new product or our existing product. So it can be hit or miss, and I've had a number of different experiences, but a lot of really good ones where we're working hand in hand in groups. And it's definitely been an evolution for me as I've been at the company the last 7 years, right out of college, where it's like, I'm trying to just absorb and meet all these security engineers, regulatory engineers, privacy engineers, these seemingly different silos. At least for me, my experiences have been that I've been fortunate enough that they've been broken down as in some fashion, and I get good visibility and collaboration with the different teams.
I think my experiences are pretty similar to yours, but at one point in my career path, I decided to really specialize and think through how to learn and do offensive cyber so that I have a better idea of how to secure it. And I've discovered that most companies really don't accept nor invest into red teaming, let alone stuff like chaos engineering. So companies are perfectly happy being situated with the notion that if a risk occurs, I have a mitigation effort. And when the risk does occur, I'm liable for this amount. So the solve is never for keeping something safe. The solve is for how much can I lose and expect to survive. So it's a very different world for me on the red, blue, green team versus risk management. So from a pure security side, it's really fascinating where I often find people who do invest in red teaming to really understand criticality and vulnerability in their business model versus those who don't.
I think when it comes to vulnerabilities, one thing a person sometimes tend to forget is the person on the other side that has the device, the one that inevitably is at the end of it all. What I have learned from my perspective is that we often speak different languages and we have different perspectives and context. And it's only now recently that I've learned, thanks to Eric, a little bit about the green team stresses and pressures and contexts that I was able to shift. And I do believe that if we understand the whole ecosystem or all sides of it, that we are able to actually communicate effectively. Now, I have another question, and this might be a touchy subject. In terms of looking at the recent breaches in healthcare, is there one instance that you can say, you know, this was handled well?
Sad to say, I can't think of an instance where a security side was handled well, but the mitigation, so the legal impact of the business, that's handled pretty well, right? So, you know, at what point can we get enough lawyers to fend against the company going down? That part is handled really well from a business aspect. From a security aspect, I think the better question to ask is, why are we prioritizing different parts of security over another when the objective is to secure something and that fundamental objective wasn't accomplished?
But I mean, it's often said that, you know, security gets a budget once a breach has occurred, but it's often little too late in the whole instance of things. Eric, do you have anything to add to this?
Yeah, I don't have any personal experience with any intrusions or breaches in the industry. As you know, as a consumer being affected, you know, your email and password or whatever, for any number of things, whether it be personal applications, health applications, fitness applications, anything that is, you know, private information, PHI, PII, location information, it's a real drag to consumers that application developers, you know, either they don't know or they don't care, or there's other constraints like it, you know, maybe time, cost, money, etc., where things just don't get built the way that they should be from the get-go. And one thing that I take pride in my work is, you know, when I get a penetration test result on an application, I'm going to go read these and not only like understand, but plan to make actions on them before an application were to be released. Or if I obtain this information and provide it to other teams and say, hey, this is something that, you know, might be a common mistake if you're a new team building out a new application and you just don't know any better. So let me enable you to make the right decisions to have that long-term success. So I don't have any experience with the breach, more of the, you know, preventing things so that they don't happen. Or, you know, if they do, you know, we've got mitigations put in place that it's things like, if there's a denial of service, it's a single individual, it's not a systemic thing, building privacy by design and security and design from day one.
If I may pull on that thread, Eric, that's really, really beautiful. I love that pattern. And to kind of pile on that, for me, the way I think about security today, even outside of healthcare, just in software in general, is to be able to bring that teaming to the beginning, to be able to have security as a fundamental principle day one. I prefer to take my security team folks, instead of having a separate team, to embed them in each software dev team. So that, because I can never expect or even anticipate that any software person, developer, is going to be a security expert. I can't count on that. So to hedge that, I'd rather have security folks inserted day one.
Yeah, if I look back and reflect on a requirement that I had reviewed in the past from a security engineering colleague, and it was, you know, very vague and generic, and my background as a software developer, I don't have a formal security training background. I don't have that number of years experience dealing with these things. It's like, well, I have to ask, well, what do I do about this? How do I do this? And whether it be, you know, reflect on open source to find a library that does what we're asking you to do, or, you know, leverage another team, it's really good to be efficient at communicating and collaborating with the individuals that know, and not having everybody responsible to know everything.
So I'm kind of like crusading at the moment to try and teach developers security and forensics. So building in the information that we need to detect, prevent, and investigate a breach. And that is only done because, I mean, let's face it, we are good at defense and, you know, attack, but we're not the ones building the software. We're not the ones influencing the code or what is getting written. And that's in the hands of green. So So I think I almost see blue as and red basically strengthening the code that's produced by influencing the knowledge that's passed on. How do you guys feel about that?
I think that's a really accurate read on being able to divide and conquer the team, but to have the one cohesive team to be able to move forward with the entire stack going forward versus having separate responsibility. I'd rather not have this waterfall event of thinking security after the fact. I'd rather think about it way ahead of time.
Yeah, so I agree completely there with you that we should. I sometimes feel we do a thing that I call DevOpsSec, where security is always last in the line, where we should be doing DevSecOps all together as one team, as one collective. I often feel like we're trying to fix things at the end of the pipeline where it's super expensive for an organization or for a development team to handle it. But we don't address the things right at the beginning. Now I have another question for you guys. Taking into account the context of medical devices that have been built, where do you see the future of this going in terms of dealing with legacy devices that at some point become vulnerable? Do you guys think that will be a problem, or do you guys think that it's not going to be a problem because we're solving them and updating them at the moment?
So to step into the light of new devices coming online at my workplace or in competitors or in just in the medical industry in general, Bluetooth being a really popular technology because it's on everybody's smartphone, everybody's got an app for their product. These devices are going to remain connected to the smartphone as long as the smartphone is in the embodiment that it is. But to your point about the legacy devices, these devices are going to eventually be phased out. You know, they have a certain life expectancy for batteries and support and things like that. But there's always a risk of, you know, every device, it just takes time and money before you can find something. And we can only do our best to make sure that the legacy devices get just as much care as the new products do as we go forward.
I think it's also a really complicated balance between the consumer and what devices can be easily changed out, what can't, vice the support of the legacy devices. Even Google has now made a statement of how they're going to discontinue connectivity to older Android versions because of security risk. And I imagine that while Bluetooth connected insulin pumps could be changed out because they're external, a Bluetooth connected pacemaker or even the heart control device, I think, may be a very, very different problem. So I think there's going to have to be a balance somewhere of how to prioritize what you are going to support legacy-wise. I think that might be the best thing I could think of to try to help humans live longer.
Look, one of the things that I learned very early on in my research was that, yeah, these things are connected to patients. I mean, I've lived with them since 19, but you know, sometimes it's a question to patch or not to patch. These cardiac devices end up in surgery for a patient that wants it to be removed due to security constraints. So I think it's very important how this message gets communicated to those patients affected. A lot of them are elderly or a lot are not technologically savvy. But now, do you guys feel that the medical, you know, the healthcare professionals have actually caught up with medical technology and are able to explain cyber risks and advisories to patients? How do you think that could be combated if it's not done as we expect it should be done?
I feel that that's a matter of what that person's priority is. I think that a medical professional's priority is going to be explaining the health benefits and risks. And I think there's going to have to be ways to quantify cyber risk as part of health risk for an MD to really care about and be passionate about explaining it, and also have the bandwidth to even try to get to the depth of why it's critical.
So for me, when we're thinking about education to our patients within our systems, within our applications, there's a couple of different personas that kind of emerge, individuals that just simply don't care. You know, they put everything on Facebook, they put everything on the internet, they use the same password for every single thing because that, you know, maybe that's how they remember it, or they just don't know any better or don't care. And then there's individuals that you know, only like myself, I only buy Apple products. I have the mindset that my data is better protected in this ecosystem compared to the alternative. But I make this conscious choice about it and use password managers, use the secure private email, all these kind of things that as we see more and more devices being introduced to the market that are not just for the elderly, because you know there's new diagnoses, there's new technologies that, you know, innovation every day, we're going to start to have more and more users that have more of the mindset of I'd like to know what can I do. And for that, we can certainly provide education, whether it be materials that is directly to a user within the application, like when you're setting up your email and password, just mentioning, you know, it's got to be this number, case sensitivity, length, strength, etc. And please remember it. Please don't make it the same as everything else. Or when we're educating clinicians and field reps about how the technology works, to kind of make sure that there's no concern and that patients really get that peace of mind because they are trusting us to keep them going or to help them in any way that we can through the device or therapy that we're delivering. So there, a lot of that education comes in where you're teaching and providing that information is a really good way to achieve that.
So I have some questions specifically aimed at the two of you, because I think the perspective that you come from is different. So Kane, what motivates someone to look into hacking medical devices? Now, I get asked this question a lot and people look at me strangely, like there should be something wrong with me, right? What is your motivation behind, you know, doing penetration tests on medical devices and so, you know, breaking into them?
Sure. My personal motivation is to help a lot of my friends wear these devices, right? Like, since I am a security minded person, I'd rather kind of give it a shot to see are the vulnerabilities I can expose. And there are. And the second half of that is that responsible disclosure. How can I communicate with these companies to effectively disseminate information in a secure way so I don't actually risk human life? So my personal motivation is to help friends, help human life.
So no plans of world domination yet. Now, Eric, same question, just slightly different frame for you. How does one become a software developer or engineer for designing medical devices? And what is it like knowing that you are designing something that has a physical impact on someone's longevity?
So a couple of my personal experiences for me, you know, fresh out of college, having a computer engineering degree, working with microchips and regular computer code and whatever it may be in college, getting a job lined up out of school as an associate, very entry level, but very quickly becoming attached because I have family members extended that have our devices, and then, you know, friends and colleagues that do as well. And so there's a personal connection that is a drive and has been a drive for me to accelerate and achieve in this space. But generally speaking, you know, you can do things like learning about security, learning about building reliable applications, learning about how to build something that's private by design and not, you know, collecting data unnecessarily just to be able to make a profit. That's not at all what we're in the market for. Because we're in the life-saving business, not in the data selling business. So it really depends on where you're looking to get into things. If you want to be more developing the product, I can speak to mobile applications, you know, just dive in, ton of resources online to get into mobile technologies. Can't really speak too much about the embedded firmware devices or the implantable devices in terms of how to get into that game or that space. But it is certainly a different way of thinking, even from a mobile's perspective. Like if I compare some individuals that work on server technologies, you know, the server will scale. We host things in the cloud. Every company does it. You know, you just put more money and the server will scale. You got more resources. You work in a mobile space. Well, you know, your application's limited to what Apple and what Google want to give you. You go over that budget, you know, they're going to terminate your application, and then the user has to relaunch it to resume whatever they were doing. And then in the embedded devices, you know, being very, very particular about every single byte of memory management. So there is different levels of scrutiny in different areas and different constraints, depending on which part of a system you're building, that are all very, very interesting and equally different in their own way.
I think what is very obvious is that the motivation behind this is into making it safer, more securely, and better built. Even though we come from very different backgrounds, for me, it's more about how do we detect and investigate that something's actually happened on a device? Do we have the capabilities to forensically look at these devices and even know that they've been a target of a cyber attack? That's kind of where my passion lies. And the reason being is we don't know that there hasn't been a cyber attack because we simply don't have the information to do so. But again, also I have a device. So I wanted to know that my heart is safe in the hands of the people that built it. And I actually got to meet the developer behind the firmware on my device. And it was a very emotional meeting because you're looking at the person's mind that's sculpted the thing that every day saves your life. Now, looking at what we can do better going forward, can you talk to big organizations that medical manufacturers are big? How do they successfully navigate building secure software and navigate this torrential road to success?
That is a enormous question, and one I think about all the time, to a point where I am actually starting to write something about it. So there's a lot of processes out there today, right? There is ISO 31000. There is the traditional risk formula, right? Like, is it, you know, what's likely versus what's the level of consequence? Problem that both is predicated upon the quality of data inputted and still guess the best. It also largely ignores the human process. So I've been thinking about my experience writing software and how I produce software and how I put my security team embedded. And I've been coming up with a concept called the risk budget. And the risk budget is really the how do I talk to people equally on both sides? How do I have my security team be able to express security problems, security concerns? And how do I have non-practitioners, the rest of the organization who are not cybersecurity, to be able to come to the table and still have a conversation? So that's something I've been framing recently and kind of writing out the process that's been successful for me. But at the end of the day, what a risk budget is this. You want to subtract the logistical problems from actual security problems and do the actual security around what's important and critical, because you can't secure all the things all the time and you sure cannot secure everything all at once. So prioritization, criticality, and a plan to go forward.
So in my role, there's a couple of different things that I can do, am doing, planning on doing. Things like, you know, if you look at certificate pinning to prevent man-in-the-middle attacks on your network stack, this is something that, you know, you're not going to go and read about if you're checking out Apple developer, Android, Google developer websites. They're just going to show you how to make the network call. They're not going to tell you why you need to do this. You're only going to know why if your security engineer, your colleague that's done it before and for either reaction or preventative measures has told you you need to do it, and then you go do it. Things like that, where it's simple enough and it takes a lot of risk out of play, just do it. Make a standard, build in tools that you can inspect, you know, hire pen testers, do internal testing, make sure that your environments are set up to, you know, manipulate in such a way that you can prove that your application is doing what it's supposed to be doing. Other strategies that you can put in your applications for other security mechanisms, like preventing denial of service on your implantable device, or maybe denial of service on the application that connects to that implantable device. These are more ideas that you can rinse and repeat across projects, but not necessarily have the same implementation, because, as you know, like as an example, a cardiovascular implantable device is far different than a diabetes pump in terms of what it does, you know, one delivering electrical therapy, another one potentially delivering insulin or other devices just in general, maybe they don't do any kind of delivery of therapy and they're just reading data. So I'll, between creating reusable components and tools that you can put into place and enforce, advise, encourage teams to implement, and then building more of a, here's a documentation strategy on setting yourself up for long-term success, making sure that you're checking the right boxes and doing your due diligence. And then be maybe to call you out on a couple of things, some of the conversations that, you know, that we've been working on, where talking about developing logging as a first party feature of an application for any number of reasons, whether it be the developer, the forensics engineer friend that you've got, or it's the field tech support, whoever it may be, building robust logging solutions to enable you to analyze items during development, during your initial release, and all the way through your production and through legacy and retirement to the device, monitoring things at all points in the life cycle of that product.
So I kind of, thanks for calling me out. Like, you know, I'm the one that's heading the panel. I'm not supposed to be called out. Well played. I think what I realized is we all do incident response. All of us, red, blue, and green. And how I came to the conclusion is, like Eric was explaining to me, that they do in-field investigations when they have to debug something. And I'm thinking, but that's like the incident. Your incident is that your device or your application is not functioning. And then I sat and thought, from when I've done some, you know, pen testing and reverse engineering, well, that was an incident as well. I was investigating how to break into something. And then you have me on the forensic and incident response side that looks at a security breach. So we all end up looking at the logs, but often the logs are designed by developers for developers, not necessarily taking into account what we need for security or what we need for investigation, and sometimes even leaving trails for red team to find. I don't know if you guys know the statistics on sensitive information disclosure and data breaches recently. It's said to be 80% sensitive data is disclosed during a data breach, and a lot of that information comes from the logs. Why do you guys think that there's so much sensitive data being leaked into an application log?
So one thing might be the understanding of trust between systems. Like, you know, if I am putting a log on my app and I send that log to my server, you know, in theory, it's encrypted during rest and it's encrypted during in transit. And if I'm naive and don't know any better and just assume trusting everything, then, you know, I'll go about my business. But if you've had conversations at length with another member of another color team, you might realize that, you know, it's intended to be placed in this data warehouse or secure storage, but, you know, somebody might by accident find some information, come across some information, or, you know, if you're analyzing a bug in a mobile app and you look at the logs and there's information that a developer put in there, not knowing or not considering that it was, example, PHI or PII, one of the corrective actions you can do is in your logging requirements, design it such that you are not putting that information in there. Maybe you're hashing identifiers or you're obfuscating these pieces of information that is a one-way hash algorithm. So if you hold that information in another context, you can run it through the same one-way hash and then you can resolve the same number. And then you can verify that your logs are emitting the pieces of information connecting to the things that they're supposed to be doing. So there's a lot of work that can happen just by making a developer think in a different mindset about what to log, how to log it, why to log it, who's going to have access to it, and how long is it going to live.
Very well thought out. The other thing is on the whole transport of logs. The thing that I would worry about, I guess, from the red team side is that I tend to use opportunities like where logs go or how logs are transmitted is either ways to external data or even as an attack surface. So if that making the transport mechanism logs used, then just for me, it's a way to get in. So I think there's also going to be some kind of a meaningful way to talk to both the SEC team, the login team, and the dev team about how do we transport logs in a secure way and how do we ensure that it's a one-way ingress.
You know, this is the kind of thing that I like hearing, because this is the thing that people don't often know, that the logs are often the key that opens the door to the red team. Now, based upon me talking a little bit, last question that I am going to ask you guys, to zero trust or not to zero trust?
I think that's a hard question for me to consider when there are so many in this case, edge devices kind of moving around. And I don't feel it's the device itself that you're going to have to lock down. It's the communication between device and the whatever the data device is. So I guess in most instances, that would be the Bluetooth connection. So what can we do to optimize security around Bluetooth? We make this assumption and accept from the council of management Bluetooth that there's a bunch of security built in, but simultaneously there's a bunch of problems around the authentication scheme around as well. So for me, I don't think it's so much as a question around to zero trust or not zero trust, because the fundamental connections, the Bluetooth connectivity between, is the biggest attack surface, then I would worry about securing that first.
So I might have a little bit of an interesting thought process on this. Being in the mobile space, I don't only just think about, you know, is the iPhone platform as a whole secure, or is Google Android secure? But I also think about, is that third party library that saves me a little bit of time, should I be using that? Should I just learn what it's doing and write it myself and control it myself? Or should I research, you know, an algorithm that does whatever it needs to do? Should I research it and write it by hand? What is the trade-off to accept some library? Do you just trust it blindly, or do you use it with caution? And I always tend to write things by hand if I can, write something that we control internally and share it across the teams and have revisions on it. You know, open source is a wonderful place. You see open source and you then have that source too in public visibility, which you might get some benefits of, hey, people reporting bugs, and then you can go inherit and fix those things through the updates that are made to the repositories. But my natural tendency is to not trust anything and to build mitigations many times over as often as we can to make sure that, you know, doing a risk analysis. Well, what if the flash memory is compromised? Well, then you encrypt your data to make sure that it's not encrypted. Well, what if they can get the keys? Well, then the key is a different place than where the data is. So, you know, building in several layers and walls around it. At some point, you're going to have to trust something. But when you have mitigations put in place, you're burning down that risk as much as you can.
I love that. That's something I worry about constantly, is the software supply chain, right? And for me, I tend to go towards the open source route more and more and trust certain libraries, but check and verify for myself before blindly using. So I tend to corral how my developers can get to certain libraries to pull down. Like I tend to control my dev network so that folks can't just go willy-nilly out and grab what they want. There's a verification process of what isn't trusted and how we can maintain it. I try not to fork existing open source projects, because for me, it's hard to maintain things. So there's now a separate domain knowledge necessary to be in a certain team, which I try personally to avoid. Granted, I am not creating that device like yourself, so I don't have that high litmus to cross. But for me, I also think about sustainability.
Yeah, so there's definitely a need sometimes to use a well-established library that specializes in one thing. You know, they are the experts in this case, not me as an individual developer, or me as a team with my colleagues. So there is trade-offs and making sure that updates are made timely to the field where vulnerabilities, if they're identified, they get patched, or, you know, new features or whatever it is that's benefiting the patient, that all comes into play when making those kind of decisions.
So to end our time off, I would like to end it off on a positive note. What is the one piece of advice you can give to manufacturers, engineers, or someone generally in this space? Or what is the one thing you want to highlight that they've done well? You know, something positive to end it off, because the world's in turmoil still with COVID 2 years on. So let's end it off with a positive note. Ken, you're up first.
Thanks. Well, first of all, let's say thanks for inviting me here. It's been great. Hearing folks like yourself and Eric talk gives me the warmer fuzzy that things have obviously done very, very well in Medtronic. So kudos to Medtronic and your teams. As for advice, stay curious. It's how I survived in the security game this long. For me, is to always wonder, not always be scared. You know, security is a weird frontier to be in, and at times it can be scary, but fear should not be the motivator or the demotivator. It should be the end goal of how can we all get to the same equitable share of data and everything else.
Yeah, I'm really excited for the future. I think you hit one of the big things that I had in mind about being curious as a mobile developer that likes to partake in the annual developer conferences each summer, eagerly anticipating the fall release and all the new things. You always have to be on top of things to learn the new technologies. Like, let's say you're not building application support for the fall updates at a compile time perspective, but your users are going to go and install the latest operating system because that's what they're told from marketing, from the big Apple and Google campaigns that they see all over the internet and on TV. So one of the pieces of advice I would have would also be to stay curious, go research new things. Technology is ever-changing landscape, especially in mobile. It changes several times a year, and these big companies have reacted quite well to the global circumstances by providing new capabilities and technologies in their SDKs, like HealthKit adding symptom tracking that you can do for if you're making a COVID application for a state or a country. Like, these are awesome things that are happening, and it's super exciting. And I can't wait to see what big companies and small companies alike make with what's coming.
Thank you very much, James. From my side, I just want to say to the community, if you are curious about medical devices and you want to research them and you want to break them, you want to figure out how they work, do it. Take a chance. If you find something, disclose it responsibly. If you're a developer and you're curious, often developers make the best pen testers because they understand how the applications and devices are built. So just be curious. Be excited. It's a whole full circle. You don't have to subscribe to a single color and say, I'm only green, I'm only blue, I'm only red. In the fact of it all, we're actually all working together towards a common goal. So from my perspective as a patient, also thank you very much for building these devices, because otherwise I wouldn't be here. And it's now since 19, and I just celebrated my 34th birthday. So I'm very happy with my device. And thank you very much for joining me. And that is all we have for you guys today.
Thank you.
Thank you.